Good morning. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this, the Sunrise Safari on a where you can't hear me. Can't hear me?
Just what you got up, yeah.
What?
Yeah, I can't hear you.
Something's going on with the audio. Sorry about this. 1 minute. No, I should be fine. I can see myself. Can you hear me? Okay, there we are. Don't know what happened there, but welcome to it, Sunrise Safari. It's not quite as smooth an opening as I was hoping for. I'm standing here on a termite mound, sitting in the manner that a leopard might, and we've come into the area where Shadow was yesterday at some stage of the day, and she, of course, likes to lie on termite mounds. She's a 9-year-old female leopard with a little cub that we're hoping to see. I've yet to meet the little cub. My name is James Henry. On camera today is Viam. Viam, give us your thumb. Oh, of course, he's zoomed in. It's very difficult for him to do that. That's Viam's thumb, everybody. And on the other vehicle, driving around at great high speed, I've no doubt, Brent Leo Smith and Gendre is filming him. In the final control, Kirsten and probably an array of pretty ladies helping her out today, as well as some pretty men, including Connor and Eugene. Now, the sun is about to come up over the eastern horizon there, and you are on a live African safari from the middle of the iconic Kruger National Park, and that means we'd very much like to hear from you during the course of the next 3 hours. You can talk to us on Twitter, hashtag Safari Live. Ask us anything about what we're seeing here, the immediate environs, or you can ask us about the continent in general. Africa, of course, I learned yesterday, is 5,000 miles long. That is double the width of the continental United States, so it is a very, very big place. Its area is 3 times that of the continental United States, so you can fit the United States into Africa 3 times. And I think a lot of the time people are under the misconception that Africa is one relatively small place of either savanna filled with animals or wars, but it is in fact a massively diverse continent. Now, we're on the southern tip in South Africa, which of course is quite possibly the most beautiful country in all the world. Let us go and see what we can find. Shadow doesn't seem to be on that termite mound. I certainly didn't notice her while I was up there. And I'm going to attempt now to go down towards the south, then we're going to turn to the east, because Karula, the 12-year-old female leopard, with her 2 little cubs, now 4 and a bit months old, crossed north onto this little reserve that we call home. It's called Juma, and we're hoping to see her and those little cubs this morning. Are you ready, Viam?
Yeah, boy.
Wonderful. Let us continue. Right, Brent Leo Smith has managed to break his vehicle even before they went out. So he's not out at the moment. He will be shortly, I hope, so that he can aid in the finding of these leopards, or perhaps even some lions. We did have lions calling last night, and thank you to those people who are keeping an eye on the Juma Dam cam. Apparently a female leopard did wander past there at some stage during the night, and so maybe that was Karula, and maybe she was going down to have a drink and then she's returning to her babies. And apparently many of you did think it was indeed Karula. And for those of you who don't know what the dam cam is, there is a feed which you can find at wildearth.tv, which is a live camera feed of the waterhole. And as this dry season, the winter, progresses, it's a really good idea to be watching the dam cam, because of course the winter is so dry. Sorry, there seems to be an extremely loud noise going on in my ear. I was disconcerted by the sound of a female guide out. I don't know who that is. Perchance we shall come across her during the course of the drive, Viam. Wouldn't that be exciting? Yes. You prefer a leopard? Well, fair enough. So I did hear lions calling during the course of the night. Now, a question from Desert Eagle, first question of the morning. Thank you, Desert Eagle. I'm not sure where you're from, so please do tell us where you are asking your questions from. It's always nice to know. Desert Eagle, you want to know if we get coyote or coyote type species out here? We do. We get something called a jackal, which is a bit like a coyote. The black-backed jackal and also the side-striped jackal. They're not very common though, but they look very much like coyotes and have a similar sort of scavenging behavior. Yum, spotted a kudu, everybody. Male, young male in the flush of youth. Magnificent spiral-horned antelope. He's a big fella, that. He probably stands about 5'8" or so at the shoulder. And he's about 500 pounds, you know. Ooh, I can hear some hyenas. Those hyenas are off to the west of us, just calling their last before the day comes. Can you hear that? Well, certainly the kudu can hear it. He's a magnificent fellow, he really is. So you can age a kudu from the length of their horns, not the length, the number of twists. And that one seems to have almost three twists, so he's probably about 4 years old. It's half a twist every year. So one twist every 2 years. Huge ears, of course. Now he's eating the delicious leaves of Ziziphus mucronata, the buffalo thorn, which are actually pretty edible for human beings. We, of course, don't put our faces into the bushes to eat them because that would result in many scars, because they're very, very vicious thorns on the Ziziphus tree. Beautiful.
He needs to wash behind his ears.
He does need to wash behind his ears, doesn't he? He's got very grubby ears. He needs some earbuds, or what you might call Q-tips in the United States. They'd be quite big. Alrighty, let's move on from here. I just want to, while we still have a chance to follow some very fresh tracks, it's worth just keeping going as the dawn breaks. Oh, but quickly, let's just have a quick look at the mountains. Look at that. Hello, I walk in the rain from Iowa. Very good to hear from you. You want to know if I'll show you some lion cubs today. I walk in the rain from Iowa. I would love to see some lion cubs, so certainly we'll pop about to Biffleshook Dam, where that pregnant female seemed to be about to set up a den, and we might be lucky. But remember, there could be another little den on the reserve at the moment. But remember, lion cubs will normally only be with the pride once they're about six weeks old, and the ones that were born here, we think probably about 3 weeks ago, they won't be moving with the mum yet. They'll still be staying very much still in whatever hidey hole she's put them. And if they are very new ones born at Biffleshook Dam, they will be completely immobile. The only real chance we'll have of seeing them is if she's moving them from den to den. And sometimes you do see these females walking across an area with their little cub dangling from their mouths, sort of looking like this, but totally, totally still. And we might be very lucky to see that. Thank you, I walk in the rain. Let us continue. Just listening to the Game Drive channel in my ear. Nemo, you've given us a lovely update which I had realized but I hadn't made mention of. Sindile was seen yesterday at Arethusa by two of the guides, I think as the afternoon drive was closing, I think. Anyway, he was very nervous of the vehicles and he skedaddled off to the north, but he's fine and seems to be doing very well. Now Sindile, for those of you who don't know, remember I mentioned Shadow earlier, 9-year-old female leopard. Sindile was her son from the previous her previous litter, and he made it to a year old, her only cub that's made it that old. And then he caught a rabid dog. Yes, I did say rabid dog, that's what he caught, that had come onto the reserve from somewhere, and so he was sent to rehab. Really, he was sent to rehab, and he spent 8 months in rehab, and he showed no signs of the disease, so they released him again. But at the process, obviously, of darting him, taking him into the confines of not a cage, but certainly a very limited enclosure, have resulted in his being rather nervous of vehicles. And so we're hoping that he will rehabituate to cars, and certainly by the time he left, he was completely comfortable around us, and even on foot, we could go and view him on foot and he would just kind of sit and watch us. I wouldn't try and do that too much now, but he's back in town and we're hoping very much to show him to our fans on Wild Earth very soon. There's the sun, Liam. Do you see it? It has peeped up over the eastern horizon. What was that? Did you get that, Vim?
Sindile's on Elephant Plains.
Sindile apparently is on Elephant Plains at the moment. So that's to the west of Arethusa. And Arethusa's to the west of where we are now, so basically exactly behind us, given that we're driving into the sun. Well, keep an eye out here. This is around about where Karula likes to stash her babies when she's out on the hunt, if she's on Juma, and it would seem that she is on Juma. Tammy, nice question from you, thank you. You want to know if there are any differences or how we tell the differences between all the cat tracks. Tammy, there are some very obvious differences, and the major one is size. So leopard tracks and lion tracks are completely different sizes. The next smallest cat, I suppose, would be a serval. That's much smaller again. So I mean, a big male lion track's the size of my hand. A big male leopard track about the size of my palm, toes all in. And then a serval track would be sort of, I'm sure you've seen a house cat track, about twice the size of a house cat track. An African wild cat would be the same size as a house cat track, maybe slightly larger, but you wouldn't notice the difference. And then we get a cheetah track, of course, which looks like a leopard track, just a bit longer, with, you will sometimes see claw marks in it, and it's much more exploded and expanded. So there is a slight difference in shape, but largely it's the size that tells us the difference, and that's obviously what tells us the difference between male and female tracks as well. I'm thinking let's pop past the dam here, see if there's in. No, you know what, we're not going to do that. We'll come back past this way. I'm just interested that Karula would have gone all the way up to the Juma Dam. She could have had water down here. She may have just been patrolling though, so I don't know. Let's just have a look-see. Are there any tracks around here? And we'll go around to Treehouse Dam. It would be so very nice to spend the day, or certainly the morning, with her and her two little babies. Vian, would that excite you?
Yes.
Vim, what have you got for picnic this morning?
Banana.
Banana.
Pear.
Very nice.
Naki.
Naki. coffee.
And everything that I just showed you times 2.
Okay, right, very good. I'm most pleased. Everything that he's shown me times 2. Vyom gets very hungry on drive. Just seeing if I can see any tracks. I can see some civet tracks. They're not going to help us in our quest for leopards. Dan, I missed your question, so I'm going to ask Kirsten to read it to me again. Vyom was showing me his picnic. Dan, you say you hear a lot about baby animals and you want to know if there are many times that we see live births on drive. No, not often at all. Certainly not with the cats and the dogs and the hyenas. They give birth in privacy, and so we wouldn't expect to see them. But we would expect to see sort of the herbivores giving birth. I've seen it once only in about 10 to 15 years of knocking about in this area. And that was, when was that? That was in November last year. I saw a zebra giving birth for the first time. But it's not that unusual to see impala or wildebeest giving birth. But to see one of the cats giving birth would be almost impossible because they do seclude themselves. Some hyena tracks. Let's go down this way. Some white-tailed mongoose tracks. None of which are very obvious, so I mean, if I see an obvious one, I will show you. Oh, it's getting a little chilly down here, Vyom. We didn't get a weather report. Kirsten, what's the weather report? Now, you see, the weather report is a great work of fiction, probably greater than the works of J.K. Rowling. Apparently 12 degrees Celsius, 54 degrees Fahrenheit. Absolute rubbish. It was supposed to be the same yesterday, and yesterday was freezing. Today, not so much at all. So I think I'm going to have to ask Kirsten to find a different weather site, because the current one is just a great load of lies. What have you got?
Egg.
An egg?
Yes.
Have you ever spotted an egg? Really? No ways. It is an egg. I imagine this is a Franklin egg, everybody. We'll have a look at the bird app now and just check if we can see. I'm not going to touch it because I don't want it to be disturbed, but it looks to me like it's been kicked out of where it was, and probably a little depression in the ground here. There's not many scrapings around here, but perhaps it was here. Impala shouting at each other. I thought maybe they were alarm calling. They're not. So what a Franklin will do is come and sort of scrape a little sort of very slight depression in the dirt and lay the egg. And it will then sort of sit, but not normally out in the open like this. So that's quite interesting. I don't know. I mean, that's very vulnerable. Mongoose will come and eat that if they can get hold of it. A very little bonus for a mongoose to get an egg like that, and I know that there's a troop of mongoose that live in the termite mound over there. So that's quite interesting. I'm not sure what happened there. Let's consult the bird app while we find our leopard. Right, I've re-plugged in. A quick look here. Oh yes, come on now, technology. Francolin. Uh, Jen B, you say, are we sure that that egg isn't part of Viam's breakfast? No, it isn't yet, but it could well become.
Put it on the engine.
Yeah, we could just put it on the engine. Yeah, I think that is a Franklin egg. You see, that's the kind of thing that they make there. Can you see that at all, Viam? If I stopped throwing it around, you mean. That's the kind of nest that they'd put their eggs in, which is a sort of depression in a bit of grass. So not normally exposed like that. And that's precisely what the egg looks like to me. So I think that that probably is a Franklin egg. How it got to where it is, I don't know. I suspect quite strongly it's not going to survive to adulthood. I'm just putting my blankie on my leggies. Right, on we go. Viam, do you think we go towards Twin Dams or towards Treehouse Dam?
Twin.
Okay, deal. So, just to get, sort of orientate you slightly, Karula was seen basically in that direction over there. That's where the Juma Dam is. And she was seen coming north out of Little Gowrie yesterday evening before drive ended. And so we're going to go kind of and survey the area between and just make sure that she hasn't crossed over this area. She does like Treehouse Dam, which is off to the other side, but I think let's go with Viam's instinct. And that way, if we don't find her, I can blame him, and if we do, I can claim credit for asking him. I think that's a fair arrangement, don't you, Viam?
Absolutely, I agree.
Hello, Aaron in New Zealand. Welcome to it. I guess you must be almost in Friday in New Zealand. You want to know which South African animal has the most subspecies? Which South African animal has the most subspecies? You mean actually occurring in South Africa? I think probably there probably aren't any. Except maybe the blessed book, which is Bonte book has a subspecies of the blessed book. And those are, I guess, they're two different subspecies of the same animal. But I guess something like a giraffe, which occurs in South Africa, but then has many subspecies outside of South Africa, could be a good one. So giraffe have 9 subspecies. Leopard have 9 subspecies as well, distributed throughout the world. But for the New World.
Dacos?
They
got lots of subspecies.
Do they? I think there are lots of different daca species. I thought you'd seen some dacos. So Aaron, I'm going to think about that, but I think actually only occurring in South Africa would be the blessed book or the Bonte book, a picture of which I shall show you now. I'm not seeing any leopard tracks at the moment. Luckily, I have our finest tracker cameraman with me, so he will be scouring the landscape. It's getting a little chilly as we head towards Twin Dams, isn't it, Viam? It is the coldest route. I'm most impressed if I don't drive off the road while attempting to read a book. I want to show you a blessed book because we don't find them here. So let's just stop over here and have a little bit of a listen. Right, there's the hartebeest, many hartebeest. Where's the blessed book? I thought I'd seen it. I did see it, hang on. I know this is very entertaining to watch me hack about here. There we go. Blessed book, Bonte book. So that's him, that's them there. And I, as far as I'm aware, those are the only two subspecies that actually occur only in South Africa, if you know what I mean. So, I mean, if you look at something like this, Sabi or Topi, They are found throughout Africa in different subspecies, but only one subspecies is found in South Africa. So, Aaron, I hope that answers your question. Very nice. You might be wondering whether I have something growing out the front of my head. I do not. This is where Gendre has decreed the microphone must live, and while it does look slightly ridiculous to have it in my head, it probably looks slightly less ridiculous than it is now. I did strap it to my chin yesterday, and some very kind person put a screenshot up of me with it attached there, and I looked very like Abraham Lincoln. And Merrick in Buffalo, you want to know if I am becoming a unicorn. You thought this might be a horn bud. Lois, sorry. Lois, no, not a unicorn just yet. Let's carry on up the road here. This is Gendre innovating all the time, you see. Right here. Hello, Red. You want to know if I got back at Brent for scaring me? Everybody, Brent scared me the other day. He came running out from behind a bush. And he made a big noise like a baboon. And Brent, of course, does resemble a feral baboon in many of his habits. And Red, I didn't get him back, he got himself back. Because what he caused me to do when he ran out and gave me a fright like that was to use a profanity while on live, live, of course, and that is a big no-no. And he then thought that was very funny, and as he walked back to his vehicle, Kirsten had to crash cut to him because I lost signal. And he laughed at the cameraman and said, ha ha ha, I just made James say beep as he came live. So he actually got himself back, which we all thought was very funny indeed. He then fell out of a tree 2 days later, and I felt that that was sufficient recompense for his appalling actions. I also don't have a voice quite as loud as Brent. Brent could easily be employed as a foghorn on a tanker. He has an extremely powerful voice. And so to give him a fright with my voice would be very difficult. Now I'm driving so slowly along here because I'm hoping to see Karula's tracks. This is round about the area towards which she began to walk, we think, from the indications on the Juma camera. Now, it's almost impossible to give a completely accurate description of where an animal is moving when you see it on the Juma dam cam, but we think it's around here that she came. Right, Brent Deer Smith is finally up and running. He's fixed his car, he stopped braking it, and he'd like to say hello to you.
Welcome to the Sunrise Safari. Now, I do apologize for my tardy, very tardy start this morning. Now, of course, I have no blame on this. Firstly, we had a little tech issue. The tech team is so amazing, they fix it quickly. But my cameraman, on the other hand, I'm at a loss for words. And then couple our cameraman, Gendre, with Chelsea, they're about as incompetent as, let's think about how to put this, about as competent as an elephant in a Tupperware store. So I've now done two trips backwards and forwards across the quarantine clearings for hard drives, for various other things that I have no idea what are used for. And of course, I just want to go find some animals, which we're going to do now. And I think apart from being late and not being able to go follow animals when I want to, I've been called a feral baboon by James. My very elegant dismount from the tree has been mentioned 3 or 4 times, which I'm going to cover shortly. Well, when it goes about baboons, I think I'm a bit larger than any baboon that's ever existed. However, James Hendry is about the same size as the large male baboon. He just lacks the large canines. But now we are leaving Chelsea and the hard drive to go do something. I'm not sure. Jean-André is now trying to be nice and keep the camera away from Chelsea. See, Chelsea, why are we late today? Chelsea, the camera's on. Chelsea's running away. Okay, let's go find a leopard. So that is my mission for this morning. Apart from having a bit of fun with James, we're going to go try find that female leopard that appeared on the Juma Dam cam. So we often speak about thinking like a leopard. So this morning I thought I'd take it one step further. I'm not only thinking like a leopard, but I decided to dress like a leopard. So underneath my many layers from the cold, I have my very special leopard shirt on. As you can see, there you go. I have rosettes on today, and hopefully those rosettes are going to bring us a little bit of leopard luck. And of course, this is Safari Live. We're on a live African safari, and you can also ask us a few questions if you would like, and you can do that by using the hashtag Safari Live. And of course, we're all very excited. This weekend is going to be our first TV shows of the year, I think, Jean-André? Yes, our first TV shows of the year. And very excited for the Father's Day weekend special. Now, of course, Father's Day is a wonderful day. And being on safari, I'm very lucky in the fact I've spent many, many hours on safari with my dad. And he's actually taught me a lot about what I know. And my reading of elephants, I think, is almost exclusively from spending time with him as a kid and a teenager with elephants. And my dad has an amazing understanding of elephants, and fortunately I managed to pick up on quite a lot of that. So very excited for Father's Day, and for me this Father's Day is going to be very special, that we're doing our first TV shows, and my love for the African bush and a lot of my knowledge comes from my dad. So very, very excited. And strange enough, my dad doesn't ever watch the show. While we're out on drive, he's doing the exact same thing at home. He is out in game drive. So every day is I know it. While I'm looking for leopards and lions and things, he's doing the exact same thing at home. So very, very excited. I think he might actually watch this weekend. I'll have to give him a call and remind him. But like me, if he hears a kudu alarm calling or the call of a wild dog going woo, 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 he'll stop watching and head out into the bush to go try find those animals. Okay, so this is where the leopard came from. And judging from the tracks, I'm almost fairly certain it's the queen of Juma. And look at that. We don't often get tracks in that incredible morning light that show up so nicely. There we go. So she's around here somewhere. Now, very exciting news is that I got a report that she took both her cubs into Juma last night. So I'm sure she stashed them somewhere. And I think I know where she stashed them, or in the general area where she stashed them. And she's headed out hunting. Now, what we really want for her is to make a kill in this area, because it's really far from the southern boundary. And we want her to sort of set up again on Juma. So we're going to go check across to the north, along the east, northeastern side, towards Mvubu Road. We might take a gander at the hyena den, see if there's been any action where Jamie found that hyena. And we're very excited to have a hyena back on property. Forehead, and that is Jean-André's fault. And I, of course, being me, I refuse to have a rat on my head. We are going to modify that, but it is, of course, in order to give you guys the best quality sound. And according to Jean-André, it's difficult for the presenters, because I move, scratch, jump up and down and mess with my mic the most, but I do try not to. Sorry, Jandre. Jandre is still not looking impressed this morning. Why are you not impressed, Jandre? I'm getting the silent treatment. Oh, dear. Dear. So, we're going to go check towards the north. While we do that, let's go see what the very funny, but sometimes very unimpressed, James Henry has to say.
Hello, everybody. Back again we are. And we're driving very gently along a road called Ingwer Alley, which basically means Leopard Alley. I've seen leopards around here many times. And this is sort of the direction in which we thought Karula might be coming. No one has seen a track of hers yet. And Taxon is not out. Oh, shoot. You're right, Vim. I nearly swore again. Are you okay? I didn't stop. There's an overhanging branch. Whoops. You're used to it. Sorry about that. No one's seen a track of Karula yet, and so I'm not really sure where from the dam she went. So this might be a good starting point. It'd be very nice to see her basking in the sun with her little babies. We may or may not be lucky. Go again with that, Kirsten. Oh, okay, so Brent did show you some tracks of hers at the pan, but after that we don't know where she's gone. Now I must tell you that I did get out of the vehicle briefly while you were away, and I created a very nasty damage to myself. Yeah? Shall we show everybody? This is not for sensitive viewers. See, I have a very severe injury on my leg. I kicked a zebra wood by mistake in my quest to find animals for you. So let it never be said that the job that I do is not very risky indeed. Not so, Viam?
Yes.
Yes, there's an impala. I can't reach the clutch to stop the car. Now, when you're looking for leopards, a very relaxed looking impala is not always a good thing. Looks very chilled out. And you can see how much darker, for those of you who are regular viewers, you'll see how much darker he is. And he's fluffed his hair up to trap more air underneath it, and so he can stay a little bit cooler, at least warmer, not cooler. Viam, of course, has done first aid training course. Viam, have you ever actually administered first aid? Because I seem to recall asking you many times before to help me, and you have refused.
Well, I killed Brendan one time.
You did kill Brendan. We did have an emergency... we had an emergency kind of drill the other day, and Brent was bitten by a snake. And... towards the end of the exercise, Brent couldn't breathe anymore, so we had to help him. And we put that mask over his face and we were ventilating him. And Viam unfortunately tilted Brent's neck at the wrong angle, which meant that no air at all went into his lungs. So unfortunately we failed and Brent died during the course of our emergency.
What did he call it, a failure?
Viam says he's not sure that that's a failure. That's not actually very funny, that's very dark humour. We have to take that very seriously, Viam.
At least I know how to administer air now.
Exactly, at least you know how to administer air. Someone like Brent Leo Smith. He was very heavy to carry to the car. I think we eventually just dragged him by one of his legs. He swore quite a lot for a dead person, didn't he?
Yes, and laughed.
Yes, he swore and giggled quite a lot for somebody dying of a mamba bite. Yeah, I can't see any further tracks around here, but we might be lucky. You know, so often you come out in the morning with a prospect like this, the leopard's been seen at the dam camera an hour before you go live. Niggies. Hello, Deb in Ohio. Before I refuse your request, let me just check these tracks out. Here she is. Hooray, we've got her tracks. Are you impressed, Bjorn? I actually didn't see them, I saw the civet. But she is here. Okay, her tracks are going along the road here. Let's keep going. Deb, you say because I'm good at animal impressions, especially the Nyala, would I be prepared to... What have you seen? The leopard?
A Nyala.
A Nyala. Would I be prepared to do an impression of a rhino, given that I seem to have a budding horn and we're not allowed to see them? Deb, let's see if we can't find this leopard. I'll tell you what, if I don't find the leopard, I'll do a rhino impression for you. But if we do find it, I'm going to refuse. Right, I'm just going to call these tracks in, everyone. Stations, tracks of female leopard head west on Ingwe Alley. I'm following up. They are only about 150 meters to the west, at least to the east of Philemon's Dip. So basically what I've done there is tell everybody exactly where the tracks are, where they're going. And so now we'll try and follow up. And Taxon's going to come and help us. Let me just check if the cubs are still here. Well, the cubs are here, they're not. Keep a lookout here, everybody. I wonder if she didn't go and have a drink, having left the cubs around here, maybe with a kill.
I vote the milkberry.
The milkberry, where the other on Philemon's cutline. I think she may have taken a shortcut down here. We're going to drive very slowly down here, scouring every single marula tree for the draping limbs of an antelope, perhaps. She may or may not have nerded. But she's also very close to a very secluded drainage area here. Hello, Ellen and Iris and Christine and Anna. You all want to know what my hood ornament is. Well, it's an impala horn that Viam found, and we thought we'd just put it there to see if it, was usable as a sort of good luck charm. So far, it has borne us a little bit of fruit.
And your leg.
And my leg, of course. My leg did become mangled in its retrieving. All right, let's see if she pops out onto the road here. I wonder if she's not in the drainage line there. I don't see her tracks here. Vim, have you got them that side? Not.
No.
Yeah, she's not here. Oof, I've got a feeling she's not far away, everyone. I don't think anyone's driven down here today. Just checking the drainage line here. Right, what I'm going to do is just go for a little wander through here and see if we can't pick up some of the tracks. While I do that, let's head across to Brent and get an update from him.
Welcome back, and unfortunately we are experiencing a little bit of a gremlin issue this morning, but we're going to try to sort it out as soon as possible. So we're meandering. It'll just be as simple as changing a cable. and that normally seems to sort it. So we're going to go test that, but we are still looking for Queen Karula at the moment. I know James has got some. Do a check around here.
Still good to go. So I don't know that she came round the corner here. Just keep looking in all the trees around us, under every bush. She could easily just be lurking around here. I mean, these also could have been the tracks that, would be taking her up towards the waterhole. BMP, will you just keep an eye out that side?
For tracks.
Well, the animal as well, you know. I mean, animal possibly even better than the tracks. Just saying. There she is. Okay, let me go back a bit. When I say there she is, I'm sure sometimes people must think, goodness, does he mean the actual leopard? And no, he doesn't. He means he's seen the tracks. I think they go off in that direction. Now, of course, leopard tracking for somebody of my skills is, it's relatively easy when they're walking on soft sand on the road. But as soon as the leopard disappears off the road, it becomes an entirely different matter. The cub tracks are not here. There's some civet tracks around, but no cubbies. I wonder if these weren't the tracks of her going north. Let's just have a listen. Maybe there's a bird sitting watching her and will alarm call. I don't hear anything. Okay, Brent is now black screen, so we can't go to him. So I am just going to step out of the car briefly. You will remain within sound contact with me, and I'm going to just check the sandy patch just off the road here. Now, when you're tracking like this, it's very important that you be very quiet. Make sure that you don't make too much noise. There are some birds alarm calling up ahead. So I've got the last track over here. So I'm just going to quickly check into this patch of dirt here, and we'll see if we don't pick her up there. You still hear me, Vimpy? And we just keep an eye out, and we listen very carefully, of course. There could easily be a growl if she sees me, and she has her youngsters with her. Or alternatively, just to rustle in the bushes as she moves away. Because that's what she's most likely to do. But I don't see any tracks here. I wonder if she maybe didn't go north into the block. No, I don't see anything here. And the last tracks are on the road just in front of us. But there have been elephants and impala and all sorts of things knocking about this area. One last look up here. And then we'll turn around and we'll carry on down the road here. And just keep an eye out on both sides. No. I don't see any further tracks here. Leopard will like, they like to use roads, so she'll come, she may have popped out here, walked along here, and then she would have sort of fed across here, and if she was going that way, an obvious sort of game path like that one over there was probably where she would have gone, but I don't see any tracks of her here. There. Maybe she went north. Anyway, we keep up our search. As I say quite often, I think sometimes this tracking malarkey, while it puts us in the general vicinity, the actual finding of the animal is often quite filled with luck. Okay. Let's keep trying. Liam, you still have not offered assistance to my very severe wound.
I have the right to refusal.
And Dr. Debbie, whose title I could certainly use right now in my very painful state, you say maybe I should hang my leg out of the car for a while. And maybe that would attract some bloodthirsty predators. Well, that's not a bad idea, Dr. Debbie. I'm not sure how many predators would see my rather fleshless leg and decide it was a good snack. This is where I heard the alarm calling birds. It sounded like a batis. I'm just going to turn around here. Hello, Sandy. You say, is there a plant out here that would help with this nasty cut? Yes, there are a couple of plants that people use for disinfectant. I think it's probably best to just leave it, though. I'm just trying to think. Ziziphus actually is used as a disinfectant every now and then, and also as a sort of anti-inflammatory, if you like. You can crush it up and then sort of put it over the wound. But I'm not going to chew up some Ziziphus and put it on my wound. I think I'll just leave it to survive. Because of course the redder and more bloody it gets, the more guilty Viam will feel, and eventually he will offer me assistance. Or not. I'm just going to call these tracks in again and just announce that I don't know where they've gone, and then we're going to go down there. Justin, you want to know if there has ever been an emergency with a safari guide and or a tourist. Yes, absolutely, there have been many emergencies. They're not common, but when they happen they tend to be very well publicized and, you know, difficult to, well, you can't keep them from the public eye, I suppose. They're not common, but they do happen every so often, just by the very nature that you live in an area that is quite remote. Most commonly, though, quite interestingly, when emergency medical services are called out to these lodges or to these wildlife areas, it's because somebody's had a heart attack or a stroke. So in the same way that the most medical emergencies in the towns are probably heart attacks and strokes combined with car accidents. We don't have car accidents here. Far more people are affected by diseases that would have affected them anyway, like a heart attack or a stroke, than they are by an animal sort of attacking. Let's just go past here. Right, we'll watch carefully to see if our tracks don't pop back out onto the road. I wonder if she's not inside this drainage system here. I don't see her there. I suspect she'd be in the sun at the moment, given the temperature. No, nothing in there. A leopard, of course, can hide almost entirely in plain sight. The umpy is also scouring the landscape. Brenty, I'm afraid, is really struggling at the moment with his signal. He's got no signal. So they are trying to fix that situation. Just call this into Taxon quickly, because he does have a tracker on the front of his car, and Fanotti is a very good tracker. Tax, do you copy? We'll just keep looking in here. Taxon, Taxon and go. Tax, I couldn't see where those tracks went, north or south off the road, but they didn't come out on Philemon's dip. So I don't know if you're going to come into this area, but yeah, I don't know whether they went north or south. Just going to let you listen.
I don't know if it's the same concert that will come, you told us that Saturday.
Copy that. So you think these ones might be from last night?
Yeah, maybe it's the same concert that came from that side and joined very close to the southern side of Inga there and went towards that muddy there. And from there, I don't know where she's from.
Yeah, okay, copy, thanks, Tex. Alright, so what Tex is saying there is that he reckons maybe that these tracks are from last night. She went north past the Bryside area, which is basically an area where they have dinners in the bush, and then to the water, and from there no one really knows. So I think we should carry on to Treehouse Dam, and let's see what we find there. What say you, Wiam? Yes. You don't want to take this road?
No,
Philemon's cut line. Now, Joey in Australia, you would like to know what the biggest kind of prey Karula will take is. What's the biggest prey a leopard like Karula will take? Well, she weighs about 45 kilograms, that's about 100 pounds, and you'll find that the biggest prey that she can take is something almost twice her size. An adult male impala is the biggest she does take, and she does take them fairly regularly, especially during the rutting season. And during April and May, she took a number of adult male impala, especially while she was feeding her little babies, or while she was lactating and therefore having to eat a lot. And so she would regularly kill a 70 kilogram or sort of 160 pound animal. So between 1.5 and twice her own weight. But adult male impala is probably about the size limit that she can take. Righty. But that's, and she'll actually be able to hoist that up into a tree, which I think is utterly remarkable. Most of us find it difficult enough to do a sort of pull-up on our own, let alone carrying something our own weight. Kirsty, I'm sorry, there was mountains going on the Game Drive channel. You're going to have to give me that again. Oh, Gremlins General. Hello, Gremlins General. Wonderful Twitter handle that. Where are you in the world? It'd be lovely to know. You want to know, would a leopard eat that egg that we found? Absolutely. Leopards have what we term a Catholic diet, i.e. very wide, very unfussy. If it's meat, a leopard will eat it. Or if it's protein, if it's from an animal product. And leopard is the ultimate un-vegan, if you like. So they will eat anything from termites to giraffe. and everything in between. So an egg, I imagine they would find very tasty indeed. Well, we're just going to drive very slowly down here, and then we might can this area and head towards Biffleshoek Dam, where of course that lioness we think has been about to give birth. And that would be very exciting. Ooh, hang on. Sorry, one sec. Go ahead, Tex.
Young one, what are the people for shadow?
Where's that, Tex?
Well, Bridge Road, just north of the retail exit.
Okay, copy. Thanks, Tex. I'd like to make my way there.
Yeah, he's heading straight east.
Copy that. I'm on my way. Have you got visual? Is he relaxed?
He's not Saba, but yeah, he just...
Sundile. Sundile, everybody. Okay, copy. I'm going to come there as soon as I can. I'll be there in 2 minutes. That's a lie. Not unless I've got a jet plane will I be there in 2 minutes. Okay, he's heading east. It's Sundile. He's on Aubrey's Road. It's quite far from here. So we're going to drive quite quickly, everybody. Hold on tight. Now, ideally, we would, of course, link to Brent for this speed, but because he can't actually be with you, you're going to have to put up with the speed. I don't want him to cross out of the area, and I think he's going to be quite difficult to follow. He's moving quite quickly. It's a brisk, I've said we've got about a 30% chance of seeing him. I'm sure all of you want to see him. I'm desperate to see this leopard. So we're going to give it a go and see what happens. It'll be so nice. Vim, yeah. Would you be excited to see him?
Yes.
And Kirstie, can I have that question again, sorry, while we speed along at 100 miles an hour? Ah, Travis Jackson, you say, what's my favorite wildlife to track? Travis, interestingly, rhino are probably my favorite wildlife to track, and that's because they're not very hard to track. And I'm not very patient, you see, and to track a cat through, say, the block when they're not on the road, I love tracking rhino because they're a bit easier to track, and I've had some wonderful rhino tracking experiences. And you can get really quite close to a rhino without it noticing you. And I've had some unbelievable on-foot experiences with the rhino. And so I guess that would probably be my favorite animal to track, Travis. Hold on tight, everyone. At least we're getting these kind of teething problems out of the cars before the TV show. And for those of you wondering why we're not being regular about our shows at the moment, the afternoons have been allocated to private rehearsals at the moment. Excuse me. So we're doing two shows for the Father's Day weekend this weekend. For our first 2 hours of our normal afternoon safari, so 3 o'clock Central African time. And we're going to do those live to Nat Geo Wild in the States, which is very exciting indeed. But we need to be really on top of our game, practicing things like ad breaks. And we've got 4 feeds out, so we'll be in the tent. There's the tent as we go past it now. On quarantine, Jamie and Brent will be in the car. Steph will be on foot, so we've got 4 feeds out, which is fantastic. We may even have a rover going, which will be really exciting. And the rover, of course, is a little sort of robot, a remote-controlled robot with a camera on him. Gives you really low angle. So that's what we're going to be doing this weekend. We're not that far now. Tax, I'm on. I'm at Gallagher Shortcut Junction. Is my best approach still Aubrey's Road?
Jim, you went straight east.
Okay, copy. I'll still come to Aubrey's. He's in this block here, everyone.
I don't know if he has there's another gate that will follow the jump along the block here, which is Yemi. Well, right here. But yeah, I will suggest best approach. Go. Yeah, tell me that you just need to help on this road.
Okay.
Stand by there. Standing now to the top.
Okay, copy. I'm in that area right now. I'll just get to just east of Aubrey's Road and I'll stand by. He's turned towards the road, everyone. He was going east, now he's turned south towards the road. Oh, this will be very, very special. This little fellow was my very favorite. All right, Brent is back up and running. Let's go and find out, get an update from him as soon as we see this leopard. As soon as we see him, we'll cross to you.
So hopefully all our tech issues are, we might gonna go sneak in front of James. He doesn't know where we are. So we're also gonna hang around that area because I know how excited everyone would be to see young Sindelai for the first time in many months, actually probably since the first time since we saw him. Jandre is about to sneeze and making really funny faces. He swallowed an insect. Sorry, I can't take it seriously. Jandre's face. But we're gonna just hang around the area. Maybe we can sneak through as well. Oh, he beat us. Apparently he's moving straight towards James. And so we're gonna sneak in as well. Just quickly. So we're gonna try sneak in there as well. Tex, I'm also in the area, but as soon as the next person who wants to come in comes in, I will move out. Okay, we're gonna go across to James. We're just gonna jump in ahead and try and get a nice shot. Imagine how wonderful it would be to get a shot of James and Sindile. So let's go to James.
Okay, everybody, he's coming through here. He's coming east along here. And Aubrey has got sight of him. We are in some very thick bush here. Watch out, everyone. Watch thorns. Okay, we need to go east now, but I can't get to the east from here. Yeah, we're gonna have to go through here. Watch out, VMP. Copy that. Right, so this is where we heard him revving the engine, Tax. So he's somewhere around here. Is that not him there? There. There's the vehicle. The vehicle's just in front of us. Tax, I've got your visual. Where's the animal? It's just in front of Tax on there. I know this is a bit noisy, everyone, but really it's worth it. Just in front here.
Yeah,
He says he's going to come out in front of us, but there is some really thick bush here. There he is. He's just there.
Yeah.
Affirmative, thank you. There he is. He's straight in front of us here.
But in front there, I know that it's going to be maybe a little bit more up and close to Fiatel. Sorry, that other shortcut there. But he's just still heading east.
There he is, everyone. There's Sandile. I've got visual of him. That's so fantastic. What the fuck?
Get front of mine. Jagerman? What's your luck, fellow? Face her off. Copy, Malo. That's all? Yeah, I'm by the bumper.
I'm just gonna try and get through here.
I know, but I'm just staying near the area. This is young, young bumper, Yali.
Brent's just gone past us. I don't know where the leopard's gone now. And my earpiece has come out. It was just coming through here, everyone. I think he's gone down here, don't you, Wimpy?
No.
Let's go down here. Hope we can see him again through here, everyone. What do you think? You got a track there?
No, that's a missing story.
No, but he was going this way. He was going kind of in the southerly direction, so I'm going to carry on down here. Everyone, it is very, very thick in here. But we saw him, everyone. We saw Sandile. And I don't think he looked too nervous at all. I think he's getting used to the vehicles again. We got to be careful. You've got to try and keep your distance.
Sandile, and he's in one of the most difficult blocks, and I wasn't actually trying to steal James' sighting. We're just trying to give him a hand because leopards can disappear so easily around here. But isn't he looking well? That's my first sight of him since I saw him in a tree with a dog. Beautiful boy he is. And I know he's one of James's favorite leopards. He's just stopped in the thicket here. I'm just going to get round. How's that? Forward. There he is. Isn't this exciting? For those of you who are not sure who this is Shadow's only cub to survive to adulthood, but he has had a really tough life. He attacked and caught a dog that tested positive for rabies and then ended up in quarantine for nearly a year, before being re-released. And since then, he has been wandering all around the Sabi Sands. And isn't this exciting to have him on Juma? James, he's heading towards you now. I'm going to try to stick with him. This is a very, very thick block. It seems like the leopard prints paid off. I'm just going to be on the radio with James quickly. James, do you have my audio? From where you are, if you head straight south, you should get him. I might lose him behind this thicket. Okay, we're going to try to sneak through here. You got him through that gap there, Jean-André. Wow, he's grown so much. He's gonna go, he's heading back towards his favorite presenter. Well, I know he's one of James's favorite leopards. As you can see, this is a really difficult area he's going through at the moment. But it looks like James is right there, and it looks like James might have a view. We'll find out in a second. Okay, quickly across to James.
There he is, everyone. What a profound... This is just fantastic. I don't know if we have maybe lost sound or something.
Got you.
But this is just amazing. Look at him. He's in good condition. He looks like a typical young male, but for his obvious necklace, of course. It's one of these collars that falls off itself. So while we're tracking him now, it will eventually come off. Look at him. Oh, hello, boy. Hello, fella. Look at his two spots. On the one side. Oh, this is too brilliant for words. He's a magnificent looking fellow. And apparently he had a kill hoisted into a tree, so that he didn't learn from his mother, the sort of lack of hoisting. So three spots there on the right. Look at him. He spotted something, everyone. He spotted something just behind us. Seen something around here. Go ahead. Yeah, affirm, he's coming down the termite mound where we're sitting here. This is just brilliant. Should I go back a bit, Vim?
Give it a second.
Yeah, Tax, where you saw me there, he's just on the termite mound here. Lying down now. Just going to go back a little bit here. I've got a great view here, Vim. Shall I go forward for you? How's that? Oh, look at him. This is just fantastic. And what a joy to spend a bit of time with this fellow. So, just to recap for you, everybody, little Sundile here is. He's just about 2 years old now, and he had to go into rehab because he caught a dog. As leopards do, leopards will catch other predators often. And he had to go into rehab. He spent 6 months in rehabilitation while they just assessed whether or not he was going to get rabies. He didn't get rabies, and there was a lot of consternation about whether or not they'd bring him back, whether he'd ever be back here with us. And he was, you know, he was such a special leopard to be around when he was little, because he was so confiding and so curious and just so wonderful to be with. And here he is.
Here he is.
He's back again.
He's back again.
And all is okay.
All is okay with him.
Great
and
wonderful joy for everyone concerned.
Everyone concerned.
Let's try and get one nice picture of him. And look at the sun shining on him. And I don't know, I'm going to get pilloried by people for saying this. We think that his father's Tingana. Pink nose, he's got three spots on his left, our right. And he's got that very obvious kind of grey scar above his nose. I don't know if you can see that. Now he's going to have a bit of a snooze. Now we were told that he was nervous of vehicles to start with, which I guess he must have been. But now he seems to be pretty relaxed. I'm so excited. Now maybe he'll set himself up here. And please take your screenshots, everybody. It's so great to see him. So take lots of screenshots. Let's remember this. Let's celebrate this moment. Oh. And lying exactly like a cat should lie, really, isn't he? Yeah, so Bear, what I was saying about this collar is that it will, it's self-releasing, it will detach itself as he gets larger. And it won't be that sort of, it does look a bit constricting, I must say, but that means that it is going to fall off. And he'll get so used to it so quickly, you know, I mean, so many animals can live without limbs. So that little collar, while irritating to start with for him, will be absolutely fine. Brilliant stuff. Vimpy, you quite happy to see this fellow?
Absolutely.
This little friend of ours?
I thought he's going to be Anderson meat.
I thought he might be Anderson meat too, but you know what? I mean, I hate to say this, Vimpy, but he looks slightly to me like the Anderson male. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
He's got that sort of paleness about his face. I mean, I think it's almost impossible to say that, you know, to give with any certainty from his look who his father might be, but he does have that Andersonish type.
Yeah.
visage.
If he becomes as big as a lioness, then we'll know.
Yes, if he becomes as big as a lioness, then we'll know. So we think, everyone, that Tingana, who is our dominant male leopard of the area, is his father. We're pretty sure that that's the case. You happy with that shot? Yeah, that's perfect. And Christopher, you say, is it possible he's looking for Shadow? I think it's not. I'd love to see them meet up. I don't know what would happen. But you know, he's beyond that stage where he needs to be with his mother. I just might have to give Taxon a little bit of an idea as to where we are. While I just try and help Tax to get in here, let's go across to Brent.
Isn't this amazing? I truly thought we would never see this leopard in the wild again, and it's incredible that he is roaming the
Tax
Sabi
just
sands again.
Straight west.
And he's looking so healthy. Look at that. Oh, isn't he beautiful? I can't help but take a few pictures. I hope you guys are getting some great screenshots of him. He is looking really well. He's a bit hungry at the moment, but other than that, he is absolutely splendid. I do absolutely love it. Look at that. Definitely better looking than his mother. And if we come out wide, and we can see James looking at young Sindile. And look at that. Well, look at James. He's taking a photo. Vim's got a look of deep concentration on his face. James is looking at the pictures he's taken. But let's look at the leopard, rather. So what we're going to do now is, James, I think, has got a better view than we do. And I'm going to move out for some other people to come in. And leave James with young Sindelai. So, James, I'm going to take... Okay, there we go. We have one last look before going across to James. James is just busy on the Game Drive radio. Oh, look at him. He's looking so well. So I think James is off the Game Drive channel. I'm going to take over from James on the Game Drive channel. So let's go to James and his favorite leopard.
There we go, everybody. What a real joy. And it is very difficult to get in here, everybody. So we do have to spend a bit of time on the Game Drive channel just helping everyone in here. One of the guests has said he's seen another leopard down there. Whether that's true or not, I don't know. We're just going to sit still, everybody. We're going to wait here and let things play out. We don't want to have too many vehicles moving around at the same time. And at the moment, it's just little Sindile and us. So Brent will go and just help them look for the other leopard, if there is another leopard there. Vian thought he saw, what did you think he saw, a nyala or a buffalo wandering black down there, something black moving down there. Here we go. Let's just watch out here. Taxi's moving, he's coming towards you, Taxon. He's up, he's moving. He's now moving in a northerly direction. Tax, I can't follow him from here. I'm going to have to go through the other side. He's just gone past the northern side of the termite mound. Okay, let's carry on. We'll see if we can find him again. He's just around the other side. Shouldn't be too hard to get there. I do just want to keep my distance a little bit, just so that he can hear what's going on. And if there is another leopard in there, he needs to have his wits about him completely. So we're just going to ease our way through here. Here's the termite mound where he was. I think he was walking off in that direction there. Okay, hold on everybody, going to be a bit of a noise. I'm just going to ease through here. Yeah, he's gone down through here somewhere. Tex, did you get visual? So here's the termite mound. See him anywhere, Vimpy? I think he's probably headed that way. But it is very, very thick in here indeed. Right, everyone, try and be patient. I know that you all have had an incredible time here, as we have too. I'm just going to decide which way he's gone. I don't know if Texan's got a view of him. Tex, have you got a visual? Texan, come in. Tex, did you get visual of him? Tex, did you get visual of him? Okay, he's gone down that way. Okay, copy, thanks. Okay, we're going to try and ease our way through here, everyone. It's very difficult to tell what's going on because there are about 74 vehicles trying to get into the sighting, which is fair enough. It's absolutely fine, and there won't ever be more than three in the sighting at a time, but it does mean it's just quite difficult to follow him. Okay, I'm going to go through here. We're not going to make it through there, are we, Viam? Viam, of course, is the practical one of this little arrangement that we have. The elephants have made such a mess in here that it's almost impossible to get around. But I do see a nice clear path from here that goes off towards the east there. So we might be lucky again. But even if we aren't, what an amazing sighting. And yeah, it's a real joy. There's a road up ahead here. Yeah, they all went down through here. We'll just follow the vehicle tracks for now, I think. Oh, big drainage lines all over the place. Yeah, we're not going to get across this one. I wonder if he didn't go down through here. What do you think, Vimpy? What's your instinct say? Around. Liam's standing up, scouring the area. I think Tex has got a view of him. So. All right, let's go back to Brent. I think he's out of this thick stuff. Let's try and get around.
What an amazing morning. How exciting to have young Cinderlai back in the area. Of course, as exciting as it is to see young Cinderlai, it is a possible threat to Queen Karula and her cubs. Now, even though he is related to Karula, if he came across those cubs, he would pose a massive threat to them. So we're still not quite out of the thickets yet, but we're in a far more open area than... Oh, we've got to watch out very carefully for things like that. You can see it there. It's a very large hole. A very good morning or to Shell in Detroit. Shell's wondering, would Tingana allow him to stay close to Juma? Oh, sorry, I'm getting caught in something here. And sorry, Shell, I'll be with you in a second. And I don't know what is going on. That. Aha, there we go. Nope, not quite. How on earth did that happen? That is a very strange... I'm not sure how that was even possible. Ah, that's how it was possible. Okay, I'm back. Sorry about that. Cable confusion. So, Shell's wondering whether Tingana will allow him to stay around Juma. No. Tingana would definitely chase him and try actually kill him if he got the possibility. There we go. Aha! A road! Yay! Now, of course, being young Cinderlai, he has definitely chosen one of the more difficult areas to stick with him. Oh, there we go. Isn't that exciting though? But it is, as I said, as exciting as it is, it does sort of throw a spanner in the works for the leopard dynamics. Tingana will chase him. I think Karula might even get quite aggressive with him if he comes across her. And Karula was in this area earlier. So I wonder whether he's maybe picked up her scent and trying to see if he can get a free meal. So I know what we're going to do now. Jandre and myself are going to go have a good look at the hyena den, the one that Jamie found that single hyena in recently. And maybe we'll be lucky to see the first emergence of the latest edition of Juma hyena cubs. It also gives us a good chance to check around towards Galago Pan, see if we can find any tracks of Queen Karula. Remember, if you want to ask us what's going on, who's that leopard, why has he got a collar, use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. I'm pretty sure James probably covered this, but the reason that leopard has a collar is he actually caught and attacked a rabid dog. Jandre and I were there. And I remember I was driving, heard on the radio, oh, he's caught something. We literally got there seconds afterwards. And I went, it's a Steen dog. I didn't know what to do. And of course, very sadly, that dog turned out test positive for rabies. So he had to go into quarantine for probably just under a year while getting treatment. Now, rabies can take quite a long time to manifest in certain animal species. So they had to keep him for that really long time in quarantine. And he was then released very quietly into the Sabi sands. And now he's back around. He's done some magnificent wandering. And the scientist who's put that collar on him and keeping up and to date and following his movements is pops his wonderful maps up on Facebook. And it shows you how he's been moving. And the scientist has nicknamed him the Wanderer. Of course, we at Safari Live know him as Sindile. Or as sometimes we say, mispronounce, Sindalai. We've had some amazing times with that leopard before he went into quarantine. Jamie's been had him follow, after tracking him and finding him on foot, Jamie's had him follow her back to the car. This is with him on foot, sort of sitting on top of a termite mound watching me as I try to figure out where he had gone. But so wonderful that he is back in the wild and doing well. So he was away for a very long time, and Annie's wondering, when he was in rehab, was he given the opportunity to hunt or was he fed? He was fed, Annie. So there's a very large misconception, and a lot of the, I don't know how to put this in a nice way. Put it this way, people who claim that they're having lions and leopards in captivity because they need to teach them how to hunt. I can tell you for a fact, it's an absolute load of blah, 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 blah. But any of the big cats, even if they've been in captivity their whole life, if you dump it out in the wild, all it needs to do is to get hungry. And it knows how to hunt. Those skills are instinctive. They are. They've got hundreds of thousands of years of evolution that is making sure that they have those skills. So there's no need to teach a big cat how to hunt. And I know there's quite a few of those lion farms, for lack of a better word, that claim that they're keeping these animals because they need to teach them how to hunt. And it's absolute nonsense. You do not need to teach a lion how to hunt. You can, as much as you don't need to teach.
Now, we're not really in the sighting, everybody. We're just standing by on the road here, and there he goes. He's just crossed the road, and he's going into the block there. I'm just going to find out if anyone's going to follow him. If they're not, then we're going to, because we're in a nimble little vehicle. Let's just see. Stations, he just crossed south over Gallagher Shortcut Road. If you want me to follow, let me know. Copy that. Right, tax says we must follow. I see him there. He's just gone down here, and I don't know that anyone else is going to be able to get a car in here. Can you see him? We'll try and pull in here, everyone. It's going to get noisy. Yeah, he's gone straight down this little game path here. We're just going to ease our way through, like I say, very thick. There he is, straight in front of us. Stations, he's now mobile north into the drainage. Okay, copy, thanks, Tex. He's now trotting. He's trotting through there. So it looks like he's going back to the road. Yeah. I think he's going after that. So he went down into this drainage, everybody. I don't know that I can't get through there. Stations, he's gone north into the drainage here. I can't get this car in here. That's it. Wow. Okay. You reckon we can get through there, do you? All right, we'll try it. But then, that's it. Liam, be it on your head. Be it on your head when we're with one vehicle for TV. You really want me to go through here? Okay. Watch your head, everybody. That's a black monkey thorn, everybody. Acacia burkei, favourite food of the giant jewel beetle, which Steph found on drive yesterday. Let's just get it over the camera. Oh, it's caught VM now. VM is now basically stuck in the tree. That is, of course, his fault.
Alright, I'll get it now.
Right, there we go. Do you want me to go forward?
Not yet.
Well, I don't want to go backwards because that'll take your head off.
One more.
All right, let's head back across to Brent, see what he's doing. We might be lucky enough to get another view, but I don't think so, everyone.
And now go forward.
Welcome back, everyone, and how exciting as it is with young Cindelai. James is trying to get you into the best position to get another view. Chandra and I are a bit sad we're not there to film VM stuck in a monkey thorn. That would have been quite amusing. We're going to go ahead towards the Biffles Hook waterhole now. Now, there's that lioness who's been hanging on that area, and we're quite convinced she's about to give birth, or if not, she has already given birth in one of those little dry creek systems that flow into the Biffles Hook waterhole. So always good to go check around there. Oh, morning impalalas. Careful, Cinderella's around the corner. Oh, they are just so gorgeous. And a young boy. Look at that. Looks like he's... Ooh. Looks like he's sniffing us. It looks actually look like... What, did we drive over some leopard or lion dung? That's a... caused him to be quite curious. And look how wonderfully adaptive they are. And see, can't really see what she's feeding on, but as soon as an elephant pushes over a tree, impala are one of the first animals to take advantage of that nutrient-rich, those nutrient-rich leaves that would not normally be accessible to them. And also, they're feeding on every little grass, every little bit of food that's available in this drought, and that's what makes them such a successful species, the fact that they are not catholic in their diet, and they can change and adapt depending on the season or the year even. And quite often impala, of all the species we see, are the ones that start showing the signs of the drought last. About earlier, and it's a thing I feel quite strongly about, the not keeping of animals. Look after lions or cheetah. It's generally not for the good of the animal. I really believe in most of those cases it's people trying to feel better about themselves, and in a lot of circumstances those animals would probably be better off not being alive than being kept in some of those horrific conditions and pandered to tourists. But it is a thing that I feel very, very strongly about, and of course it's one of those things that it looks so wonderful. So, I mean, let's go look after a lion cub. Now, apart from the fact that any one of those institutes, bar very few, if they ever say they're actually going to release something into wild, they're talking absolute nonsense. That animal is worth far more to them bringing in revenue being held in a cage or even in an enclosure. So it's a very sad industry, a bit like the circus. Unfortunately, most circuses these days are changing, and they're not keeping wild animals anymore, which is great in my opinion. But it is quite a hot topic in South Africa at the moment, with the canned lion hunting and these different things that are going on. But yes, it's one of those things. And I know, as I said, it was my opinion, and some of you might disagree with me, and I'm quite sure it'd be an interesting we've had this conversation around camp as well, so it is an interesting thing to talk about. Right? I firmly believe if you really love animals, you don't keep them in cages. It has been a fantastic morning with young Sindile and Vicky in New Mexico saying, well, would we consider him a sub-adult now? Yes, Vicky, we definitely would consider him a sub-adult. And Vicky's also wondering, where should he go to find his own safe territory? Unfortunately for him, Vicky, he's not going to be safe for a couple of years yet. He's going to be a wanderer until probably around the age of six years old, when he's big enough to challenge another male for his territory. And of course, as much as we would love to see him over and over here, for the good of the genetics of the area, he should probably push off quite far, we hope. But while he's this age, it's always amazing to have young male leopards around. They just pop up everywhere. I mean, oh, so exciting. You never know where they're going to pop up. So it definitely does change the leopard dynamics in the area for a while. And of course, we saw Tingana a few days ago, but he's headed off to the south. But you never know when he's going to come back. And that's the amazing thing about being out here. We actually get to have a better understanding of over a long-term period of what's sort of cracking with all the
Hello everybody. We got out of the bush, thankfully. No more injuries. Viam, quickly show us your injury. I did not offer Viam any first aid. But next to us is a herd of elephants, and it looks like they're heading straight towards the Galago Pan in a very neat line. And they've stopped now because they can hear my voice yakking away. So I'm going to leave them there, and we're going to go around straight to the pan and see if they don't pop out there to drink. With my luck, there'll be one buffalo bull there and the elephants won't pop out, but they're heading in that direction. I'm also hoping young Sindelai might come this way as well. So, let's see. So we left him about 500 yards to the north of us here. Maybe a bit more than that, maybe, not yards, 500 feet. So maybe about 800 feet to the north of where we're sitting now. His general direction was coming this way, but I think you'll find that he spotted something that VM saw. We remember when VM said he's just in front of us, he flushed something out there. And so I think he's hunting in here, and this is that big thick block with four drainage lines. It's very lovely to walk in, but it's absolutely heinous to try and drive in. And so if he doesn't pop out, it's going to be difficult to go and see him again. But I was so encouraged by how relaxed he was around the vehicles. Right, here we are at the pan. I'm going to stop the car right here and let's see if these elephants, in fact, let me move a little bit forward, we might get a better view of them coming out. Watch them not come out, and all we'll have to look at is some very old dung. They turn to get us into a good position. I'm not seeing them. We'll turn off now and then we might be able to hear them. Here they come, right out here. Brilliant. It's a stroke of luck, isn't it, VM? VM said to me, we can't film leopards, at least elephants, after we've been filming the leopard. I think we can. Marvellous. Brilliant stuff. Now, this is one of the artificial water points, everyone. So it's, this is not a water hole that is made by the landscape. And it will become more and more and more important, especially to the elephants, as we go towards the dry season. And that's simply because elephants are highly water dependent. And it's not easy for them to cope, and they like fresh water. They don't like nasty water. They don't like bad water. Matriarch having a bit of a look at us there. Oh, look at the little one there. And they're listening to us. And I think the breeze, you'll find, has just touched them now so they can smell us. And it is amazing how discomforting. It's amazing how discomforting leopards find, at least elephants find, the sound of human beings and the smell of human beings. You can see they've gone completely silent there. And Jan, a very valid question, which you're probably asking slightly tongue-in-cheek, but which has a serious answer. You want to know if I think the elephants could smell VM's picnic basket of fruits. Maybe, but, you know, it would be to these elephants, that would be an unfamiliar smell. They wouldn't really know what that was or what it meant or if it was good to eat. I think you'll find it's largely only elephants who actually have experience of oranges that would want to eat them. So I don't think that there would be a great deal of of desire. I don't think they're about to rush over here. And try and drink or take Viam's breakfast. So that cow in the front there, coming now to the left, I think is the matriarch. And I'm quite interested in why she's approaching us. We're going to be very quiet. I think she's just coming to give us a little bit of a warning. I can't really go anywhere at the moment. So we're just going to sit here and I'm going to be very quiet. And as the heart rate goes up, I'll try and keep my voice calm. VM is smiling like a Cheshire cat. She's not giving any indication of fear yet or that she's threatened. But we are a little bit on the path that they like to take. I've just realized they do like to go down past here through the thickets. And she's just assessing as the matriarch. She's a young matriarch and she's just assessing if we're actually a threat or not. That's why she's moving her back foot up and down. I don't know if you can see that. Now she's just saying, I'm not very comfortable with you. I can't really move. I mean, I could. I'm just reticent to move everybody. I'm reticent to make a noise with the vehicle at the moment. I think she's okay, though. Okay, she's going to come past. Just going to sit very still now and let her go past. Well done. This is just wonderful. So she decided that she was prepared to have us in this proximity. But we're still going to be quiet. She's smelling us. Just turning her trunk to us. So there's this little one standing next to us here. We still going to stay quiet because she's going to call the others now, I think. Then now they're talking to each other. I don't know if you can hear that. You'll have to have very good speakers to hear that. Very low rumble. And I think she's saying, come, let's go. But they're definitely, now we talk about trying to have as little effect as possible on these animals. And we are trying to have as little effect as possible, but there's no question that our presence here is affecting them. Now there's a buffalo that's just popped up into the area, and he's basically creating a bit of consternation as well. What I'm going to do, because I'm creating now a gap between these elephants, I'm going to move the car forward and get out of the way. I'm just going to give them some space. I'm going to move up here so that there is just some space between the matriarch and the rest of the herd. And then they can chase this buffalo if they want to. He'll go bungling off somewhere else. There we go. We've now opened up some nice space for them. So if they want to go back towards the matriarch, they can. If they want to stay and drink, they can. If they want to harass that buffalo, they can do that too. I know my audio is a little bit soft, everybody, but I'm not really sure why that's the case. I am speaking quite softly, of course. Being around elephants in that close proximity tends to make one do that. Wonderful sighting, this. So, Viem, are you still sad that we came to film the elephants?
I like elephants.
Young cow, Ahmed Gallagher Pan. I'm coming that side now. So there's a leopard calling everybody on the northern boundary. I'm just going to ask Brent, or ask Kirsty to ask Brent if he isn't closer by than we are, on the northern boundary between Gallego Shortcut and Aubrey's Road. Because if Brent is up there, then he needs to get in there quickly, because I think he was going to the old hyena den. But if he isn't, then we will go there straight away. I don't think it's Sindile calling. I'm pretty sure that will be Tingana or another male leopard. It would be very premature. Okay, I think we're going to go because Brent is at Bivelshoek Dam. Okay, let's move. Let's see if we can't go and see who's calling there, everyone. What an amazing elephant sighting that was. Just spectacular. They're still there. They're just wandering sort of gently down into the drainage. So let's go that way. The beefy will no doubt be cross with us. A little quick look at a hammerkop. Beautiful bird, means hammerhead, not Serbia. Maybe even take a photograph of him, he looks so pretty. Beautiful shot of all his reflection. He's still calling that leopard. Okay, everybody, we're going to leave here. Hammerkop looking for frogs. At this stage, not many frogs. It's going to be largely insects and snails. Sorry, Beefy. I'm on my way. If? All right, let's go across to Brent, get an update from him, and I'll keep you posted as to when we get to the northern boundary. Copy, thanks.
We've got tracks of that lioness coming in and out of this area, but they are, of course, working on bolstering the dam wall at Bivelshoek at the moment. So I think she might have cut a little bit further to the south. So we're going to go have a look around here, see if we got any tracks. If we don't find any tracks, we're going to go back to the last track, and I might take a little stroll into the bush. of course, certain animals out here have names and some don't. And Anya's wondering, do we name all the animals or how do we get the names? Well, with the leopards, Anya, it's just generally to work out their territory, so it's much easier to have a name. Normally, scientists will actually just use a number. So say the leopard was born on Juma, it would normally be DJ001, DJ002. But obviously, it's not so fun to say, oh, we found DJ001 this morning. So we do give them names, and how the names work, it depends on what property the leopard is seen on, and they generally get naming, and then what will happen is all the guides will get together, and three or four names will be sort of proposed, and the most popular name voted named. And the naming process seems to change quite often, and depending where you are, there's different. Now, of course, out here we. Oh, sorry, I thought I saw a lion track. And it's not. Out here, the way we do the naming and stuff is we will speak to Tax and Aubrey, who are the guides from Juma, and we'll put forward we've put forward a name, and then we'll speak to, say, for Karula's new cubs example, she spends quite a lot of time to the south, so the guides who drive there will put forward a name, and then when we all meet, the best or the name that is most popular amongst both sets of guides wins. It'll be very difficult to name every impala, and we might get quite confused to which who's who. It's quite difficult to tell a lot of the antelope species apart. And with the lions, we normally name the pride or the coalition, not each individual. Hoping this Nkuma lioness has decided to den in one of these little river systems here. Wouldn't it be fantastic to have cubs on Juma? So I've been in the bush most of my life, so I've been very lucky to have some incredible sightings. Joey, morning Joey, who's in Australia. Joey would like to know, what has been my best lion sighting ever? I did tell the story of the lion and the honey badger recently, which is definitely one of my top lion sightings. Let me try to think of another one. Actually, I think of one of a slightly different. It's not your sort of traditional sighting of a kill winning, and I've seen some amazing lion kills over the years. But I think one of the most memorable sightings for me, I was with my friend who's a photographer, and we were in the Southern Salu Game Reserve, and we were tracking lions on foot, and we found where they'd killed a warthog. And what we did is we went around. There were three lionesses and two cubs, and it happened to be sort of in one of those river systems, but it was end of dry season, so there was a lot of dead leaves on the ground, so it's very difficult to move quietly. So to try to figure out how we could get close, the lions had moved off to go have a drink, and there was a really big African ebony or jackalberry nearby. So my tracker, Ndimboro, myself and Rob, we took our shoes off. And we sort of snuck as quietly as possible to this big tree, and we sat down. And we were no more than about 12 meters from that lion kill. And we sat very quietly behind this tree. And then the lions came back, and they didn't see us. And they started feeding. So two of those lions started feeding, and the cubs were lying behind. And then... the third lioness hadn't come back from a drink yet, and we were sitting there watching, and we were actually taking photographs, and they could hear the click, but they weren't really sure about where we were. And then my tracker in Namboro was actually having a snooze. So we were sitting there watching these lions. He was sitting behind us, and he was having a little snooze. And then he obviously just heard that crunch of the leaves, and there was a lioness no more than about 3-4 meters behind us, watching us. And when he let me know, I stood up very quickly and walked at her to try and push her away. Fortunately, she moved around and then went back to the kill, but we moved out there. And that was a really special and quite scary lion sighting. What? So no sign of the tracks coming out here, so she might still be in this area. Back towards the Buffleshook waterhole. It's amazing, this lioness has been popping up at all sorts of random times during the day, because she must have a den close by. If not, she's trying to find a decent den site. We've got lots of little river systems around here, so it's a really good spot. My favorite animal in the world is the African wild dog. Olmec, morning Olmec, welcome. He is wondering, all the way from Michigan, what happened to the dogs? Where they gone? Have they left the area? And that they have. So they're denning at the moment, and both the den sites are quite far from where we are. So there's one den still in the Sabi Sands, and there is another in the Manuleti, but they are a bit far. So while they have those dens, their hunting area is pretty close to those dens until the pups are about 4 or 5 months old and start running with the pack. So hopefully, once the babies get bigger, we'll start seeing more of them again. I just want to check one last big loop around the area, see if those lioness tracks come out on our northern boundary. We continue our search for hopefully the Nkuma lioness and her cubs. Let's go see what James is up to on the other vehicle.
We're just gonna have a quick look at the dam here. We're at Sydney's dam. They've just had Karula, everybody, crossing north over this boundary. So that's wonderful. No babies, but she's gone now straight north into an area that she hasn't patrolled for a long time. Now, I don't know how many of you have been sort of paying attention to where Karula's been. And Karula has basically spent in most of the time that she's had these two youngsters, she spent all of her time down in the southern reaches of her territory, basically in the corner between her territory, and Shadows and Tundis. And I just think that's quite interesting that she's now suddenly come up north. No, she's actually just behind us, everybody. She's just behind us. Waterbuck, kudu, impala there. Now, we can't go to the left of your screen, we can only go to the right. Just going to see if we can get a quick view. There are also another 35 people trying to get into the sighting, so we won't be here for long. We will go back and have another quick look and see if we can find Cinderlei. Look, Viam, there's a Franklin. There's not much else we can do, I'm afraid, everybody. We have to just wait and see if she maybe pops out here. Crested Franklin, very beautiful Franklin. Probably the one, well, not the very one, but the same species that lost an egg at the very start of our drive this morning. A start of our most profoundly wonderful drive this morning. So I'm just listening to Ephraim in my ear, and he's just sort of, she seems to be walking around in that kind of hunting mode where they don't really seem to pick a direction of any one kind. We'll just have a quick look here. Yeah, no, she's gone north. Okay. Let's go. What we're going to do, and we've been following Viam's directions and guts basically today, and it's served us pretty well up till now, so we're going to do the same. We're going to continue east along here, and we'll go down Mvubu Road, and that is sort of to the east of the road. It's the road to the east of where we lost Sandile, so maybe he'll pop out there. That's going to be our general modus operandi, as it were. And maybe we shall be lucky again. So the leopard calling here was Karula, and she's marking her territory up north here. Listen. Just listen. You can hear the impala calling way into Bivel's Hook there. Ba, 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 ba. You can hear them. No babies with her, so they will probably be on Juma then, because we know that she brought them up close, so it's highly likely that they're actually on Juma, probably not far from the Juma, Dam, which does bode very well for the TV shows, I must say. Maybe we'll have her on quarantine clearings. Well, now this is an interesting one, and Viam and I were just discussing the exact same thing. Sam Shamsung, you say, could Karula have smelt Sandile in the area? And my initial kind of, or our conclusion was that, yes, she would have smelt him if he's been urinating. Would she have called, though, when she, because she, one would imagine that from his urine she could smell whether he was male or female, and would she call in the presence of a male leopard to advertise her presence, especially as she's got cubs, and I'm sure that she can smell the difference between Tingana and another male. Don't know that she would. So maybe she's just calling because she needs to mark her territory. But I, you know, because this is the first time she's been this far north for a very long time. So I don't know exactly. Now, Sandile was in there, about 800 yards, or 800 feet down that away. So we'll just drive along here. We might be lucky that he pops out somewhere around where we are. can't believe we saw him today. Right, Brendy's got some interesting tracks to show you. Let's go and find out what they are.
Well, we were following lioness tracks, but now we've got a big Birmingham boys track. Here's the back foot here. And you can see if I make a track next to it, how big it is. So from a length point of view, there's the back of my hand. And there's the tip of my fingers. So the back track you see is a little bit smaller. So obviously the front feet are much, much bigger because I've got to carry that, those heavy set shoulders. So you can see here's the front track. It's not quite as clear as the back track. And if I do the same with my hand, and we go, that was a bit off. Sorry. There. And there's the back of my hand, and there's the back of the lion, and there's the tip. So where it nearly comes to the top of my fingers. And from a width point of view, if we use the stick, that's how wide my hand is there. And the lion back part of the pad is just as high. Sorry, I'm causing a bit of a traffic jam here. I'm going to just move off the road quickly. Morning.
How are you?
Male lion tracks. Okay. Abel's here. He's also probably going to be looking for these lions. Let me just get out of the way for him. There you go. All right. Okay, so there's male lion tracks heading that way. To the west, straight towards the absolutely gorgeous Drakensberg. I'm just going to go down the road a little bit, let Abel's dust settle. And it is so crystal clear today. There's not a cloud in the sky. I think it's okay, Jean-André. Is the dust settled enough? Here we go. You can see the magnificent mountains in the distance. The Drakensberg, the Dragon's Mountains, as it was called by the first settlers that came into Africa. So those mountains are probably, as the crow flies, about 70 or 80 kilometers in a straight line from us. Sandy's wondering, are they part of the Kruger Park? They're not, Sandy. They are part of something that's called the Kruger to Canyon Biosphere Reserve. And there is a plan to have a wildlife corridor running from the Kruger through to the foothills of those mountains. There are some various game reserves in those mountains, but at presently they're not part of the Greater Kruger. I can't see where that male went. Jean-André, have you got tracks to that side? Negative. Ah, I've got a track here. Still carrying on. Now, we do get wonderfully close to a lot of the animals here, and James is wondering how close can we get to a lion without it feeling threatened. Now, James, this completely depends on the day, the situation. Normally, we can get a few meters away, but you watch their behavior, see what they're doing, and that'll tell you how close or how far you should stay from them. Now, when a lion gets really, really close to you, normally what happens is you will stop. Say, if there was a male lion walking down the road towards us, I would stop. I just thought I heard something there. I wouldn't push myself towards the lion. I'd rather let the lion come to me. I've actually had circumstances where it's been very hot and the lions have had a kill where there's not much shade around, where I've had a lion walk away from the kill and literally lie less than 30 centimeters, which I think is about a foot, maybe less than a foot, in the shade of my vehicle because there's been no shade around. Now that's always a funny one because now you can't move because the lion's too close. But if the animals come up to you and choose to get into your space, it's much better than us forcing ourselves into theirs. Just want to make sure he didn't. He did. Bad lion. He's unfortunately meandered off. You can see his tracks coming through here and he's gone to the north. hear a big herd of buffalo also in that direction. I just hear that burp, burp in the distance. So we're still checking for the lioness. She could still be very much in this area. But if she does have the cubs in one of these drainage systems, we're going to have to go in on foot at some stage and try to figure out exactly where that den is. We're going to continue checking very carefully around here and see if we can hopefully find that lioness. While we do that, let's go see what Commander Bond is up to.
Commander Bond is just driving around in his company 4x4 here. Very glad that he doesn't actually own the vehicle, given what we've put it through today. Anyway, Rusty has performed admirably well. We're now going down Mbubu Road. We've just reached Mbubu Road, so we'll may be lucky. We'll go and have another look at that hyena den that Jamie re-found or reopened the other day. And I don't know if you were watching, and I think Brent intended to go here today. I'm not sure if he actually made it here, because his signal was a bit dodgy. But, so he was going to try and come here. And Jamie found a female hyena at this den site on Mbubu Road, on her own, indicating that she is not a dominant member of the hierarchy and that she's giving fantastic. So let's go and see if we can find her. We haven't had sight of the cubs yet, and I think we're probably a bit early. Although, we haven't checked that den for a while, so maybe she's been there a week or two. I did check it once after I got back from leave, and I've only been back 2 weeks. So yeah, I think we probably are a little bit early. Anyway, we'll go and have a look-see. Elephants are throwing vegetation all over the road. Do you think we've picked up a passenger? Justin, nice question from you. You say, aren't there any bushes out here that would be good in tea? Well, there's one that people will tell you is good in tea. I've tried it myself. I find it fairly distasteful. But there's one that's called Cambritum hereroense. And there we go. I'll quickly get you one, Justin. Or the russet bush willow, and the russet bush willow apparently makes a nice tea. Now, I've made tea of this stuff a few times before, and it is it's just tasteless, basically. So you're supposed to be able to make it. Does color the water, I suppose. But there's another one called Lipia javanica, or the bushman's tea, that we don't really find here because it's not often wet enough. And I know Brent takes it as a medicinal tea when he's got a cold. And it's supposed to be very good for that. It's also quite a nice tea. It's kind of a minty tea, and so that's a good one. But otherwise, no. You'll find that there are very few sort of herbs out here that are very flavoursome. And I think that's probably largely because the soil here is so poor. So the nutrients in the soil are not conducive to sort of very aromatic herbs and things. But you do find a few. Right, we're going to pop down here. There's an impala there. A couple of impalas. That's not ideal when you're approaching a hyena den. It's going to turn the engine off and roll past these fellows. Not very quietly, because Rusty is inescapably noisy. On account of the fact that she weighs 1.5 tons. I hope they don't notice that there's some of their kin's horns on the front of our vehicle. Now, just to the right left of us here, there's a male kind of marking territory. You can see him horning that bush. And I think he's probably itchy. And I also think he's still probably full of sort of the rut's testosterone, so he's horning a bush. They always do this during the rut. And he seems to be still herding this harem of females. They will all be pregnant already, so he's wasting his time. You can hear it now. That lovely sound. I don't know how they don't spike their eyes out doing that. I mean, I promise you, if you were to go and headbutt that bush there like he's doing, you'd lose your eyes in 2 short headbutts. They're incredibly aware of where they are, you know, where all the important bits are. You do see the old impala that is got a blind eye. But I think you'll find that's largely because of the fighting that they do. I don't think it's got to do with this. Okay. Hold on, my audio is a bit soft. I just have to position it on my balding head. How's that, Kirsten? A bit better? There we are. It's now drilling into the front of my forehead. Can you see it, Viam?
A little bit.
It's one of Gendre's innovations, as I said, and it will eventually work, but we're very much in model 1.0 at the moment. Around we go. Okay. Now, underneath the shade of the Tamburtis in front of us, we will be hopefully lucky enough to see a hyena and maybe some little cubs. Excuse me, everybody. Frog in my throat. Don't see anything there. We'll just stop and have a little bit of a listen. Oh, there she is. There she is. She's there. She's just coming out of the hole. I'm just going to stop here. Fantastic. Now, she's almost certainly got babies in there. And I know that there is a little bit of an access point further forward. So let's just try and go there. She's got used to us now. She will know vehicles. I don't think she'll be nervous of us. With any luck, we might have some little baby hyena cubs. Maybe Sandila will pop past here. I'm just going to try around the other side. No, this is going to be the best spot. We'll just go in where we used to sort of put our noses in. I'm pretty sure that she will be relaxed about that. I'll try not to run something over on the way and make a noise. Is that all right, BMP? There we go. So she is a little bit behind the bush. Let's just sit here for a while with her. I think those cubs are too young for her to call out right now. I think they're probably suckling as we speak. That's why she's got her hind end inside that hole. And I think we're probably about a week or two away from having those cubs come out. But I might be quite wrong. That's just how long it took Madam, the matriarch, when she was here. That's how long it took her to bring her cubs out to see us. So I think it will be worth a little wait here if you're happy to sit for a little while. And while we do that, Brent has found some elephants to have a look at.
Well, no luck with the lions, but we have found a nice big breeding herd of elephants. There's a big adult female in front of us there, eating off that acacia. And just off to the right of us is a little gang of youngsters. There's a young female closest to us. There's a small one just behind her. Now, I'm hoping they might head towards the Juma waterhole. Oh, look how cute that is. Now, this is a savannah elephant. Tanner in Oklahoma is wondering if elephants would survive in the rainforest. They do, and they actually thrive in the rainforest, Tanner, but they're slightly different to these elephants we're looking at here. It's called a forest elephant, and they're much smaller, and their tusks are slightly different shaped. They go point down rather than curving upwards, and that's, of course, because they have to move through incredibly thick areas. Well, look at him, he's just playing with the dead branch. Hello, lady. She's shaking her head at us, just reminding us that she's there. Now, look at that difference in her tusks. I mean, it's very apparent which is her working tusk and which is not. You can see how short her right tusk is. Oh, Jeanne, oh, I thought we were about to get stalked in the front of us. And just stumbled across the road. Look at this little thing. Very, very cute. Probably around just over 6-7 months old. Just from its behavior, I'd say it's a little boy. There's a tuskless cow coming through next to that little Ellie. Now, that's genetically, she's been probably born without tusks. I don't think she's broken both her tusks. And we do see tuskless elephants from time to time. Recently, we saw a tuskless elephant bull. And that is far, far more rare than a tuskless cow. Hey, you! It's sniffing us, putting its trunk towards us, giving us a good smell. Now, looking at this little baby Ellie, Justin's wondering what would we do if one charged us. Probably squeal in delight, Justin, to be honest. It's one of the more cute things you can see out in the African bush. And we've had some really wonderful little baby Ellie charges. Now, the rest of the herd slowly moving out in front of us. We've got some more youngsters over there. There we go. Here comes a baby elephant charge. Well, it looked like it was on its way. Now, quite often, you've got to not watch the babies so much, but the adults. The adults, if the baby's charging you and the adults are relaxed, then there's no problem. But if they do get the adults riled, then you do have to be a little bit more careful. Ooh, thinking about it. It So that little one, just judging about from how dexterous it is with its trunk and how big it is, probably a year and a half old, maybe even a little bit older. Hello, mama. There's a big female crossing the road, giving us a little inspection. Yes. Hello, lady. And off she carries on, wagging her tail happily as she goes in search of more to eat. Let's just move back a little bit. This little one is being very, very cute. Playing around with mom there. Oh no, he's hiding behind the bush. Now you can see there's that big female who doesn't have any tusks, and Arcadia is wondering how tall is the baby. Well, a big elephant cow like that is probably around 2.5, maybe a bit more than 2.5 meters at the shoulder, maybe just under 3. So that little one is probably about a meter, maybe a little bit higher than a meter. Well, I'm actually about 1.5 meters tall. Yeah, Arcadia was wondering about the height and size difference in the ellies. They got to keep eating, and they're definitely struggling, or going to be struggling, as we go into the dry season to find enough sustenance to keep them going. At the moment, there's still quite a few leafy plants around, but as we move further into the drought, they're going to be less and less. What are you? She's busy eating a cluster leaf. Hello, big lady. There's the little one. Looks like he's up to mischief. Yes, that is a very mischievous looking elephant. Look at that. What are you up to, little monster? I'm just going to move forward a little bit so the herd passes next to us. Remember, it's always important to let the car run. Yes, I see you, big lady. That's why I'm letting the vehicle... Don't be silly. Don't be silly. It's okay. It's okay. Don't be naughty now. Okay, I'm not going to move the car. I'm going to let the elephants move away. She's just got a little bit uncomfortable there, and I don't want the ellies to be uncomfortable. Now, it's actually quite often the tuskless elephants that tend to be a little bit more difficult than the tusked variety. And I'm not sure why. Maybe they feel a little bit inadequate, but they tend to be a slightly more aggressive in my experience. Yeah, well, it seems everything's calmed down now. There we go. Let the vehicle run for a few seconds before moving. Mom, you forgot me! Mom! There we go, back with Mom. No, that's not your mom. Mom's to the left. Okay. Just adorable little creatures. Here we go, back with Mom, panic averted. Definitely quite hasn't quite mastered the use of the trunk yet. But that elephant's seen something. It's charging at something in the bush there. I wonder. I don't think it's another elephant. It could be a predator around there. It's just very strange behavior from that one elephant cow. Let's go have a quick look. When she raised her head and then dropped her head and charged off, she could be chasing a lion or a leopard, even a hyena. A kudu, oh, they could also chase. I have seen them chase kudu and other antelope. Where did the kudu run, Johnny? Yeah, I think that way, yeah, towards the elephant. Yeah. I think maybe she's just being a little bit otherwise, chasing the kudu around. Yes, we're very scary. Now, so I've seen elephants chase kudu, I've seen them chase zebra, warthog, wildebeest, anything actually, if the mood takes them. They are so massive that everything's got to really get out of their way. And the rest of the herd, you'll see their bottoms disappearing as they head towards the Mwati River system. Bye, guys. Keep a lookout on the Juma Dam cam. They might pop out there just now. We're going to see what else we can find for the last little bit of this sunrise safari. While we do that, let's go see what James is up to.
I'm back at the Galago Pan, everybody, hoping that a young Sundalai might have popped out here. But I don't see any of his tracks, nor do I see his golden dappled coat. There on a tree, everybody. What is that, Viam?
It's a mantengo.
It's a mantengo, exactly. A forked-tailed drongo. In glorious super zoom. Black against blue. Isn't he nice? He's just enjoying a bit of the sun. And the weather has warmed up substantially since we came out this morning. It's probably sitting at around... It's probably sitting at around, I would say, 20 degrees or so Celsius. So sitting at around 68 degrees Fahrenheit. Which is not bad going for, middle of winter. Hello, Mantengu. Mantengu is a Shangaan word that these birds have. Shangaan name, not Shangaan word, and it's onomatopoeic. Like most of the local bird names, it has to do with the sounds that they make. And if you'd listen to a fork-tailed drongo, especially as the dying embers of the day are fading, you could hear them saying, Mantengu! 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 Not so, Viam.
Yes.
Exactly like that, isn't it?
Not quite.
Not quite. Oh, right. Okay, well, I'm sure I can find one or two acacia trees before we get home to scrape along the top of your head.
Well, I'm sure I can find some zebra wood to scrape along your knee.
Yes, I'm sure you could. Hello, Eliza in Canada. Thank you very much for your question. You say, is it possible? Now, I must just get this word right, because the final control sent me through a astounding interpretation of the word. I think the word they were going for was familiarities. Is it possible that he might find some familiarities around here? Yes, I think absolutely he would. I think he would recognize various areas here. The final control said, would it be possible that they would find some familiarity, Kirsten? Try it together. One, two, three. Familiarity. There we are. I think he would absolutely recognize many things that he can see out, that he knew from out here about. Hopefully he stays, maybe he won't. But I mean, I have no experience of reintroduced male leopards, so I really have no idea what he's going to do. There's a little Nyala. Quite nice to see Sindile steaming out of the bush to catch it. It's a young bull, Nyala. And another one just coming in front of us, quite close by. Let's see if I can get this incredibly slow camera to take a picture of him. Come on, come on, come on, Hendry. Come on. No, missed it, haven't you? Yeah, you have. Absolutely hopeless photographer. Why aren't you on the Nyala there, Vian? Truly dreadful effort. Leo Smith would have popped off about 74 photographs by the time I turned mine on. One day. One day I'll take a man-sized photograph. Brent has his on a setting, of course, that takes 47 photographs every time he pushes the shutter down. Sounds like the dim crackle of rifle fire at Rorke's Drift, circa 1879. If you don't understand that reference, don't worry about it. It's not important. It's extremely obscure. Watch your head, VM. There we go. Kirsten's just learned to say familiarity, everybody. She is from Durban, and so it's not surprising that it was a long word for her. Generally, three syllables is where their sort of education level stops in Natal. Familiarity. Six syllables. No wonder it was such a trouble. Got it now, though. I'm going to be in a deep amount of trouble when I arrive home. Anyway, nothing she can do right now. Oh, blue wax spill. Now, we had a rather amusing time in the tent during our rehearsal yesterday, everyone. See if we can find this blue wax spill for you. Steph found a blue wax spill that had fallen from its nest and become impaled on a Sisyphus bush. Oh, it's gone. And it basically, it's quite an impressive thing to see if you sort of examine it close by. It's a tiny little bird skeleton, about that big. About 2.5 inches long, and I mean, I could bring it on drive and show it to you, but apparently on screen it looks like a sort of piece of beef jerky or biltong hanging from a bit of branch, and so I've been told that I may not do a sequence in the tent with the dead blue wax bull again. I thought it was quite good. Anyway, we'll see. Let's pop on to quarantine clearings for the last few minutes and see if anything's going on there. No more Cinderlai today. Yeah, Justin, I'm beginning to think that you're absolutely correct. You said I should keep those horns as a good luck charm. Yes, they were. I mean, collecting them wasn't very lucky at all, as I managed to take most of the flesh off my rather plover-like left leg. But yes, certainly their presence seems to have been very lucky indeed.
I think I know that word.
How?
It takes pain and yes. Turns it into luck.
It takes pain and turns it into luck, yes, because you were also very badly injured, weren't you? Yeah. Severe cut to the hand.
We'll have to go see the medic.
Yes, we're going to have to go and see the medic. And that is actually Viam. Although medic would be an extremely strong term for what I'd describe Viam's skills, especially as he's not once tried to even apply them. There is Brent Leo Smith driving past us. Well, we're driving past him more. We're all homing in on quarantine. I'm sorry you have wind on my mic, Kirsten, it's because the... Where's the fluffy? What was attached to it to stop the wind, everybody, was this thing. Now, this thing, of course, is what I had strapped to my chin yesterday when I did my Abraham Lincoln impression. And unfortunately, you can imagine if that was under your head. It's just very uncomfortable. Makes me look like I have an enormous acne chorb sort of developing. Yeah, we will sort that out, like I say, version 1.0 of the head microphone. Now it's broken.
Yeah, no, I got it back.
Now you got it back. Not much going on quarantine. It's got a bit of a summer's day feel about this, I've got to tell you. It's quite warm. And everything seems to have hidden in the shade. I think we'll do one last pop down to the waterhole, see if anything's there. And then we'll head home. Oh, not before... No. Not before Peter Bratt, who's... I think he must have been doing about 100 kilometers an hour as he came round the corner there. It's going to get better. Wait, everybody. Great excitement. Here we go. The entire technical team in one car. You'll notice there the Russian, Alex Wozniewski, is back. Connor is eating. Connor eats 24 hours a day. Well, maybe the 8 hours that he's asleep he doesn't eat. It's been a wonderful, wonderful drive. Thank you for coming along with us. It's gorgeous morning, and of course, massive highlight, Sindile. Thank you, VM, for your efforts. We'll hand you back to Brent for the last minute and see you this afternoon. No, we won't. We'll see you tomorrow morning. Bye-bye.
What an exciting sunrise safari. Unfortunately, we didn't have any success with those lions, but amazing that young Sindile popped in for a visit. I know lots of you will be very excited about that. As I said, it does change the leopard dynamics in the area a bit. Hopefully he stays to this northern corner, because Karula seems to be keeping her cubs down in the south there. So let's hope he stays away from those cubs. He does pose a very real and dangerous threat to them. It's still exciting to see him and fantastic that he's back in the wild. We're doing one last perusal around the western edge of the quarantine clearings. Also, the Karula was found this morning just to the north of where Sindile was. And she was heading east, so we might have some luck with her in the next couple of days as well. And I know she has brought the cubs onto Juma somewhere. Last night she brought them onto Juma, so they're probably being stashed in that little river system around the treehouse dam. And from Jean-Ri and myself, it's have on that vehicle. You doing a rehearsal, and we will be with you again for the sunrise safari tomorrow morning. And these mornings are absolutely beautiful at the moment, and I really love getting out there and looking at those fresh tracks and hopefully finding an animal or two. But we're going to leave you on that great note that young Sindile has been found again, looking happy and healthy, and we'll see you on tomorrow's Sunrise Safari. Juma.